Welcome to All Together Now. This is Eleanor LeCain. Today we're talking about creating a world that works for everyone. Pioneer Buckminster Fuller issued an important challenge: create a world that works for 100% of humanity in the shortest possible time without ecological offense or the disadvantage of anyone. This challenge has taken on new urgency as we grapple with the climate crisis, species extinction, and widening gaps between rich and poor in the U.S. and around the world. Our guest today will talk with us about how we meet this urgent challenge. I'm excited to introduce you to my friend Greg Watson, a world leader in systems thinking applied at the local, state, and global levels, and an early leader in addressing the climate crisis. Greg is currently the Director of Policy and Systems Design at the Schumacher Center for New Economics. Inspired by Buckminster Fuller, Greg has spent over 40 years learning systems thinking and applying that systems thought to achieve a just and sustainable world that works for everyone. Recently, Greg, along with Elizabeth Thompson, acquired the rights to Fuller's World Game Workshop, a global simulation tool designed to help players discover the options for creating a world that works for 100% of humanity without compromising Earth's ecological integrity. Greg has had incredible service in his wonderful career. He has served as Commissioner of Agriculture in Massachusetts for three different governors. He established and chaired the Massachusetts Office of Science and Technology. Early on, he understood the problem of climate change, including 30 years ago, he presented a paper on preparing policymakers to address climate change at a major conference in Washington, D.C. You may have seen Greg in Leonardo DiCaprio's 2007 documentary, The 11th Hour. Greg gained hands-on experience in organic farming, agriculture, wind energy technology, and passive solar design at the New Alchemy Institute on Cape Cod, first as executive director and doing incredibly creative work there. He led the effort to create the Cape and Island Self-Reliance Energy Cooperative. He served 4 years as executive director of the Dudley Street Neighborhood Initiative, a multicultural grassroots organizing and planning organization in Roxbury, Mass., where he initiated one of the nation's first urban agriculture programs. Greg was also the first executive director of the Massachusetts Renewable Energy Trust, now called the Mass Clean Energy Center, and he was the founder of the U.S. Offshore Wind Collaborative. His work currently focuses on strengthening community food systems and improving global systems literacy. Greg is here with us today to share his wisdom and experience on how we can create a world that works for everyone. Greg Watson, welcome to All Together Now.
Thank you, Eleanor.
So I'm so excited to have this conversation with you about your illustrious career, particularly at this critical moment for the U.S. and humanity. And I'd like to jump right in and ask you, what attracted you to Buckminster Fuller's systems thinking so many years ago?
Yeah, it's a good question. And actually, the genesis of it was, I grew up in Cleveland, Ohio. And this was back in the 50s and 60s when the two bodies of water that bordered Cleveland were Lake Erie and the Cuyahoga River. The Lake Erie was declared sort of biologically dead. You wouldn't want to consume any fish or any type of organism that came from Lake Erie. And the Cuyahoga River, many of you may remember, many of your listeners, was made infamous by Randy Newman in his song Burn On Big River. Cuyahoga was so polluted with flammable pollutants that an errant cigarette butt or match thrown off a tugboat could cause the surface to erupt in flames. So I was, even as an urban youth, I was fully aware that the environment mattered. And I got involved in the environmental movement very early on. 1967, I went off to Tufts University and was confronted by my colleagues in the Afro-American Society at Tufts University about my commitment to the environment. Now, remember, this is 1967. Everything was going on. There's a civil rights movement, the Vietnam War, women's rights movement. The environment movement was just getting started. And my colleagues in the Afro-American Society thought my energies were misguided. In fact, I was confronted with the question why I was committing my time and energy to an issue that in many of their minds was not only irrelevant to the cause of African-Americans and of people of color, but many of them saw it as being sinister or subversive, which took me aback. And when I questioned why they felt that way, they basically said, well, listen to the slogans, Greg. Limited growth, no growth. Where is there room for us to achieve any kind of economic equality within that equation? And I have to admit that I was not able to respond intellectually. Intuitively, I felt that the twin goals of economic equality and environmental equality were compatible, but I didn't have a way to respond. And nothing in my formal schooling or education prepared me in any way to sort of respond to that. And so I decided to go underground. And I discovered publications like the Whole Earth Catalog, which was a pre-internet access to tool platform. It was a book, obviously. But it introduced folks to tools for achieving some measure of degree of self-sufficiency in areas of food, energy, and shelter. And the Whole Earth Catalog was dedicated to Buckminster Fuller and because of his whole systems thinking. And I delved into the thinking and the writings of Bucky, which is not an easy thing to do, and was struck by basically his concept, his whole systems thinking. But what hit me more than anything else was his idea that nature's strategy for design was based on this notion of doing more with less. And that simple concept, simple but it's also very deep, began to point to the path of how we could achieve the twin goals. And that was my introduction to Bucky. And that led me to many of the things that you alluded to in my introduction.
That's fantastic. I hope you write a book about that. That would make a fascinating introduction to your memoir about your incredible work. I've never heard that story, so thank you for sharing that with us.
Absolutely.
For people who aren't familiar with systems thinking, how would you describe what systems thinking is?
Systems thinking is sort of a counterpoint to the way that we've probably all been taught in school, and that is to take the world and analyze it by breaking it into parts. You go to school, you go to separate classrooms for arithmetic and mathematics, another classroom for science, another for English, another for geography, another for civics, and you never get the sense that the world is actually a whole system. What systems thinking says is we've got to find a way that for people to understand how things do work in as a whole. And you begin to understand that there are concepts that you couldn't possibly have discovered with a sort of a linear, analytical way of looking at the world in pieces. One of those concepts is an important part of systems thinking. It's called synergy. People may be familiar with that. Is, you know, again, synergy is the concept that says that you can't predict the whole by looking at the parts in isolation. Corollary could be the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, but I actually prefer saying that the whole can't be predicted by looking at the parts in isolation. Simple example is that we hydrogen we sort of know is a gas, oxygen is a gas. They're invisible. They're in the at least that's what we've been told. They're nothing in the individual properties of hydrogen, the gas, or oxygen, the gas, gives you any clue that when combined in the right proportions, two part hydrogen to one part oxygen, that you get water. Water's totally unpredicted by looking at the parts in isolation. And you begin to realize that that's sort of, if you start to gain a systems perspective, you understand that nature has a way of doing things, a strategy, and I don't want to anthropomorphize here, but nature has a strategy for design that takes advantage of this system's emergent property of synergy. So it's a very important, critical way of looking at the world that gives you a whole different perspective on what's possible.
Yeah, I really like that. It's so good. When I was in college, I was concerned about the problem of world hunger, and I realized that our whole educational system was designed to kind of dive deep into these segmented areas. So you could study, maybe you study botany, maybe you study economy, maybe you study history. There's all these segmented areas. But it seemed to me we needed a much more holistic approach to understand the whole situation we're in. I was focused on the problem of world hunger and what we could do about that. So kind of drew on each of those areas, but really seeing how they all interplay to create, in my situation, to create the condition of world hunger. So I've always kind of thought about this whole holistic view, and it's, I think, a wonderful way to approach a situation. But it can feel a little overwhelming to do that at a global level with a problem so intense right now as this climate crisis. So clearly, I think the greatest challenge we face right now is the climate crisis, which is already having a major impact on our lives. We get super hot weather. We can hardly breathe in Washington, D.C. now in the summer. It's so hot. Fierce fires in California, horrific hurricanes in Texas and the East Coast. So when you apply systems thinking to the climate crisis, what solutions appear to you, and what action do you think we should take about the climate situation?
You like the easy questions, don't you?
I figured I'd start with the hard ones first.
And no, it's a good question, but I think, and as you said earlier, it can, the whole idea of systems thinking, particularly on a global level, can seem overwhelming. And that's where Hazel Henderson's phrase and her thought comes in. Hazel Henderson's an economist who said we have to think globally and act locally. So, and the idea of systems thinking at a global level is, so let's start with the whole. Bucky would even say you start with the universe, just so you make sure you don't leave out anything that's relevant. And then you quickly sort of hone your focus down to the problem at hand. But you'd want to make sure that you're considering everything that needs to be considered as you go from from universe to global to national to regional to local. And there's a way to do that, right? And you start to look at, for instance, let me give you for instance, and you say that's when we began to understand, for instance, that agriculture is a major contributor to climate change, to the emission of greenhouse gases. That may not have been apparent early on. Focus was almost linear, right? It was looking directly at fossil fuels, which are clearly part of the problem. But there were other contributors to it. And if you start to look at large-scale monoculture, industrial agriculture that has become dependent upon chemical fertilizers, pesticides, and herbicides, it has implications that go in addition to climate change, but they're interrelated. And as a matter of fact, the systems perspective says if we can address this in the right way, we can deal with issues that emanate from industrial agriculture, including soil erosion, water pollution, and climate change, and may be able to do that in ways that don't require tremendous amounts of resources. That's one of the things that the systems perspective reveals are what Bucky called trim tabs. And he said that every whole system has what he called trim tabs, which are points of leverage. And those points of leverage, if you understand where they are and what they are, can allow individuals or communities, in many cases, to find solutions to these huge problems that are both manageable at the local level and do not require an inordinate amount of resources and energy. An example is the emergence of farmers markets, believe it or not, right? Farmers markets, the oldest marketing system in the world that has now been adopted by communities around the country. When I was back in 1978, there were no farmers markets in any of the major urban areas in Boston. Massachusetts was in a crisis in agriculture in 1978 that started at the end of the Second World War, where we were losing farmlands and farmers at a rapid rate, to the point where it sort of became almost assumed that Massachusetts would no longer be an agricultural state. And many people felt that was okay, right? Because back in those days, energy was still relatively inexpensive, so it didn't seem to matter too much to folks that we were importing 85-90% of our food, much of that coming from as far away as California, from other parts of the world. But the commissioner of agriculture back then, Fred Winthrop, put together a Blue Ribbon Commission and said, "Tell me what we can do as a state to address this problem of our deteriorating agricultural system." A number of solutions emerged, including something called the Agricultural Preservation Restriction Act, which is very important because it was a way to preserve farm land. And basically, it was a way of paying farmers the difference between the development value of their land as opposed to their agricultural value. They paid them the difference, and for that money, the farmers gave the state the right to develop the land, which meant that it could not be developed. It could still be owned by the farmer, but they gave up the right to develop it, and that kept farmland in business. That kept the farmland, I should say, away from development, but it didn't necessarily keep the farms in business. Another part of that policy was to create the farmers markets, which, again, oldest marketing system in the world, keeping farmers and creating this connection between farmers and consumers. That very simple development, innovation of the markets, did a number of things. It certainly improved the relationship and demystified the myths that existed between urban and rural communities. But it also encouraged farmers to diversify their growing patterns, something that we were always encouraging to do for ecological reasons, right? Because monoculture encourages pesticides and herbicides. But the reason farmers couldn't do that is they were trapped in a marketing system that almost forced them to monoculture. And the simple act of creating these farmers markets in neighborhoods gave them another option. And that option then encouraged many of them to diversify. I'm not saying it solved the problem, but as you can see, what it did was that you were able to sort of take a very inexpensive, doable project initiative, community-based, and actually then begin to address some of the larger issues that were eventually really sort of were affecting our climate as well as our land and our water.
So true, and I started out life in Arlington, Massachusetts, and right on the border there with Lexington was this wonderful farm store, Wilson Farms, and it's been a place where farmers would bring their produce from the suburbs, and then someone would bring it into downtown Boston, and we're talking back to Revolutionary War times, and that Wilson Farms is still around today as a business and one of my favorite places to go. It's just such a wonderful thing, and I that was a hardball question I threw you. You did such a fantastic job. We do have to look at those trim tabs, like where are the points of leverage that we can make a difference with. Agriculture is one of the main contributors of greenhouse gases, as you say, and you've done tremendous work as Commissioner of Agriculture yourself in Massachusetts for 3 times. Another source is the energy, the production of energy, and I want to get to that in a minute. But while we're talking about agriculture, I would love to ask you, you did serve 3 times as Commissioner of Agriculture in Massachusetts, and I'm curious kind of what you feel about your time there, how you felt you could be effective working within state government, and what you think are the biggest achievements of your 3 terms as Commissioner of Agriculture.
Yeah, well, actually 2 terms. One was under 2 governors. I was appointed in back in the 70s by Michael Dukakis, or 90s, I'm sorry, by Michael Dukakis, just as he was making his run for president. So he left right after he appointed me, and then Bill Weld became governor, different party, and but Bill Weld kept me on. So that was one term, but two governors, and then later on in 2012, I served under DeVal Patrick. Here's what I, and by the way, I was appointed the first time in 1990 straight out of the New Alchemy Institute. So here's a black kid from Cleveland, Ohio, who never worked on a farm in his life, working at a place called the New Alchemy Institute on Cape Cod, where we were growing, and it was relevant, but it still was very different, right? We were growing food in geodesic domes, and we created something called sail wing windmills that had cloth blades, and that was quite a transition to make that move from the New Alchemy Institute to Commissioner of Agriculture. And I was a little reticent to accept the nomination, and I called a number of people, including the head of the Farm Bureau, who basically said to me that this appointment was important to him because he felt that the agriculture community needed to improve its relationships with both the environmental community and the environment. And he felt that perhaps because I had the experience at the New Alchemy Institute, and by the way, years earlier, I had organized the Boston Farmers Markets in 1978, so I got to know farmers. That was my way of getting to actually get to know real farmers, by getting them to, recruiting them to come into the city. So I had a relationship with farmers, and I had this now relationship with this and this environmental organization that was doing groundbreaking work. And, you know, I give credit to the head of the Farm Bureau at that time, who said, we've got to figure out a way of seeing how we can reconcile our practices with the concept of sustainability. So, and here's what happened. It was interesting to see. At New Alchemy, I was always preaching to the converted, right? We did wonderful work, and people came to see us, and we had people from all around the world. And you could sort of pontificate and were free to sort of express your thoughts and ideas almost all the time. There were, but you were always, didn't quite know what type of impact you could have on 12 acres in Hatchville, Massachusetts. I think we had tremendous impact, but still there were limits. The going to state government and working in government after having that type of experience, I realized there were constraints, but I also had a larger platform, right? And there were things I could do, and I had many more resources. So there was almost like this, almost a trade-off to some extent. But it was important to me to take what I had learned at a place like the New Alchemy Institute, that, you know, because I had this confidence. I knew that we could, a tenth of an acre could support 13 people with three vegetable portions a day for a full year without any chemical fertilizers or pesticides. I knew that. Now, that meant a lot of other things had to happen, right? There's canning, preserving, very labor-intensive. But given all those caveats, I knew that it's compared to an acre of land per person that conventional agriculture required to provide our sustenance, that we could do this on a tenth of an acre. That's doing more with less, right? So that was important to build the confidence. And within the Department of Agriculture, I think probably one of the major achievements was that we were able to promulgate the toughest pesticide regulations of the country, along with California, that met with the approval not only of environmental organizations like Mass Audubon and Mass PERG, but also Cape Cod Cranberry Growers Association and the Massachusetts Farm Bureau, because we were able to base the regulations on science, and they appreciated that. So we were able to make some real headway in making sustainable agriculture, really make it mainstream.
Yeah, that's impressive. And did you notice any difference when you went in 1990 time and then 22 years later DeVal Patrick becomes governor and you circle back? Now you've had 22 years experience outside of government. How were you different, and what else did you do differently coming back in as Commissioner of Agriculture?
Yeah, it's a good question. In 1990, we were just beginning to develop a campaign to get people in Massachusetts to look at local agriculture and appreciate local agriculture. We came up with the campaign Massachusetts Grown and Fresher. And the farmers market certainly helped in that regard. But that was a challenge to get people mm-hmm. to take agriculture seriously back then. 22 years later, the whole foodie movement was well underway, and what was happening in the state at that time was we were trying to sort of harness this energy of people who were dying to do more and increase access to locally grown food. And one of the things that emerged then my second time around was interest in urban agriculture. And this was different than backyard gardening and community gardening. There were clearly people in the city who were interested in exploring the potential of commercial farming in the city. Now you have to understand, this is, again, and for the most part, we worked in low-income communities. But the Dudley Street Neighborhood Initiative was one of those areas where urban agriculture, no pun intended, but took root. And that was a multicultural, Cape Verdean, African-American, Latino, and white. But these were mostly folks who don't have access to land. And it's interesting, one of the last agricultural census, that was taken maybe 2017, revealed that 98% of the agricultural land in the United States is owned by whites. And black farmers were either tricked out, cheated out of their land over the years in terms of, hundreds of thousands, if not millions of acres. So there was a yearning and a real interest in getting back to the land, but the only real option was to do it in the cities. And so that had all sorts of challenges, obviously in terms of contaminated land, lack of access to land, small parcels. But it's amazing what has happened in the short period, or in that interim, in terms of a real interest and serious interest in commercial farming. And I will say that, and again, looking at trend tabs and looking at what tools are available to encourage and support these types of efforts, give lots of credit to the city of Boston at that time under the leadership of Mayor Tom Menino, who did something pretty revolutionary, and that he saw the promise, he saw the potential of urban agriculture, he saw what it was doing, maybe not so much commercially, but certainly in terms of empowering communities and individuals and communities. So he took the bold step to rezone the city of Boston for commercial farming. Now, that's a major deal, right? Because when mm-hmm. you says you're for real. And it was a two, maybe two and a half year process that open meetings. I think they were like every other Thursday, 8:30 in the morning, Boston City Hall. And that was, you had to define every single term, right? Everything that contributed to urban agriculture had to be defined. But it was a major step in terms of a commitment, giving legitimacy, giving sort of, and empowering these communities to pursue this whole notion. Now, subsequent to that, there's been innovations around urban agriculture, new technologies, some out of reach of some of those low-income communities, but, freight farms, greenhouses, rooftop, vertical farms. So I think that that's sort of one of the, when you begin to see what happens if you can take this idea, seed it, and give it, in some cases, again, the kind of support that isn't so much necessarily, and that's not by any way diminishing the importance of capital and resources, but I think that one of the major leverage points was a policy, right? It was mm-hmm. creating and implementing the zoning regs that allowed commercial agriculture in cities or involved right. in this.
Exactly, and that's where you're using the tools of government to help direct things in a positive way. I'm not sure most people understand on agriculture just what a big greenhouse gas emissions are coming out of that whole sector, in part, you know, growing a lot of foods in California and then driving them, sending them 3,000 miles across to the East Coast so you can have strawberries in January or whatever the particular situation. But the incredible use of fossil fuels to grow and to transport agricultural products around the country and indeed around the world. So this prospect that you're talking about on urban agriculture and the rooftop farming and all that, it has just such incredible potential. You know, we've started growing our own vegetables here in the city, Washington, D.C. We just, you know, got some nice soil and separated it off and make sure it's healthy. And, you know, for one thing, for a lot of people, it's a money saver because now you're growing your own food. Also, some people in cities live in food deserts where they don't have access to organic food. So, you know, you're going to get organic because you're growing it.
They don't even have supermarkets. So they don't, in these, some of these food deserts, right, not even access to a market. So
Right. Can't get to the fresh food, so you end up eating a lot of junk food, processed foods, which now we know are contributing to this explosion in bad health and diabetes and lots of other chronic diseases are coming out of the poor food that people are eating. So this is just so important, the work that you've done there, and I so appreciate you doing it. So we've talked on the climate crisis about this issue now and agriculture and the great work you've done there and much, much more. We could spend the whole time just talking about that. But there's another whole area that's contributing to our climate crisis, and that's the production of energy and the kinds of energy that we use. And you have been early on working for renewable energy. Can you talk a little bit about your work in that sector?
Yeah, and it's interesting. I mean, even that, sort of the origins of that were, at least my hands-on experience, it, you know, it's always non-conventional, right? But there was a new Alchemy Institute because even then when we were coming up with our concept of a bioshelter, which was a self-contained envelope that passive solar architecture that housed agriculture and aquaculture systems. Actually, it was a precursor to what's now called aquaponics, back in those days where you've got fish growing in tanks. In our case, it was tilapia growing in tanks. We would take the wastewater or the from the fish tanks and cycle it through hydroponic system of cucumbers, tomatoes, and lettuce, that is plants not growing in soil, but in just some sort of substrate that supported them with their roots dangling. And then we took the water from the fish tanks, which was obviously becoming polluted. You got to stock it with fish, and the fish are, you know, are again, their waste are being deposited in the water. So it could be a source of pollution. Instead, we recycled it out of the fish tanks through the system of agriculture system, and so we no longer called it wastewater. We called it nutrient-rich water. It was a resource. Bucky Fuller said pollution is a human construct. In most cases, pollution is a valuable resource in the wrong place. And, you know, the idea of systems thinking and system design, more system design, is now taking this concept of systems and saying, now let's look at nature and see how nature does things. And the concept of at New Alchemy was to try to model your systems after nature. So we were, one of the systems that we had for recycling the water were wind turbines, windmills, actually. And so that was the first introduction to sort of a way of, again, using, creating energy to do some work that was contributing to this incredible ecological design, eco-design of a bioshelter, but where the windmills became an integral part. Now, fast forward to 1999, I was asked to become the first executive director of the Massachusetts Renewable Energy Trust, and that's the energy trust emerged after the state of Massachusetts restructured its electric utility industry, and the idea was to open it up to competition. And as part of opening up to competition, the legislature wanted to make renewable energy, clean energy, one of the options that ratepayers could exercise when they decided who they would purchase their electricity from. the trust was created as a way of trying to level the playing field, because obviously fossil fuels had a great head start, right? Oil, coal, natural gas. And so the trust was created as a way to jumpstart a renewable energy industry in Massachusetts. It was funded by something called a systems benefit charge, which is a small charge on your electricity bill based on usage. It was a system benefit charge if you supported the Renewable Energy Trust. If you didn't like the idea, it was a tax, and we saw how we do things, right? But it was designed to encourage both increased production and consumption of renewable energy in the state, and that meant that we had to do a pretty exhaustive analysis to figure out what renewables made sense for a state like Massachusetts. And when I say that, it's because, you know, again, the fossil fuels, you can, you know, you drill for them, you dig them up, you put them in tanks or tankers or on boxcars, and you cart them to where you are then going to eventually use them. But you can't do that with renewables. Renewables are basically, you know, solar. It's, and the sun doesn't always shine, and it's in certain places, and it's wind. So we had to do a pretty exhaustive analysis to figure out what potential we had for renewable energy generation in Massachusetts. And that, of course, led to a number of interesting things. I'll pause there for a second, but probably the most interesting and controversial project I've ever been involved with, which was Cape Wind, the attempt to build the first offshore wind project off the coast of the United States.
Right, I remember that project. And by the way, as you were working on this, in 1990, I was the top policy advisor to Lieutenant Governor Evelyn Murphy in Massachusetts, who was the acting governor for most of the time that Governor Dukakis was out on the campaign trail when he was running for president. So I remember at that time I wrote a speech for her saying we wanted to move Massachusetts towards zero waste. And, you know, the idea, exactly the principle you're talking about, the waste, the so-called waste from something, in the case you mentioned, the fish waste, is actually a nutrient source if it's directed in the right way, where that could be a food source. And if you think in that way systematically, if you can design your whole production cycle so that the waste from one enterprise is actually the nutrient-rich source for another enterprise. So Lieutenant Governor Murphy came out with that speech, and she took a beating for it, saying, well, that's ridiculous. You could never get to zero waste. And, you know, she was very courageous in standing up, saying it's, you know, it's a design issue. It's not, you know, of course this thing's going to be emitted whenever you produce, but you just have to design your system in such a way that that resource can be used. So totally support that. Now, yeah, the renewables that are make sense for Massachusetts, was wind at the top of your list? Because we did, you know, we don't have a lot of sun. We get some sun, but a lot of cloudy days in Massachusetts. Did wind come at the top of your list, and then solar, or what was the ranking you came up with?
Well, it's interesting. We, you know, before I was hired, right? This was in the legislature, after the legislature created the Renewable Energy Trust Fund. Before anyone was hired, they also commissioned the study. The study was interesting, conducted by both Arthur D. Little and Bain Incorporated. So they did a pretty good search. Solar did rank high, right? Particularly because residential solar, you know, again, not a whole lot, but sunlight. We don't have as much as California. We have short seasons. But solar ranked high. Interesting, wind did rank high, but there was absolutely no mention of offshore wind. And this despite the fact that Massachusetts at that time was home to an incredible individual by the name of William Hieronymus, and I love the name, Bill Hieronymus, a University of Massachusetts professor, originally was a nuclear engineer, then got interested in wind energy, and as part of his work at the University of Massachusetts, and I think I'm correct on this, Eleanor, but I think Bill Hieronymus was probably the first person to identify the fact that the energy flowing off the coast of Massachusetts, the wind energy flowing off the coast of Massachusetts, was enough to power the entire region, actually the entire United States.
Oh, my God, I never heard that. That's incredible.
And he actually believed he had designs not just for offshore wind turbines, but he had designs for floating wind turbines, because he understood that when the water gets, you know, the cost, you know, again, creating a, you know, sort of the support system for wind turbines, if you get in very, very, very deep water, becomes prohibitively expensive. And that's what designers do. So as a designer, Bill Hieronymus said, okay, as we get farther away from shore, we're going to have to figure out how we're going to support these things. And he had these incredible designs for floating platforms. This is a part of the true story. So I knew about Bill Hieronymus. As a matter of fact, I was introduced to him by Bill Jim Manuel of the University of Massachusetts. So I came in sort of hepped up about offshore wind. And I'm going to be careful here, but when I mentioned it to one of the consultants, and there was another consultant involved in sort of revising the original assessment of what technologies made sense for Massachusetts, I mentioned offshore wind, and they told me they could include offshore wind for another $5,000 or $10,000. And I said, no, goodbye. We'll do it ourselves.
Yeah, right. Well, the problem you run into in Massachusetts when you start talking offshore wind, you're looking at all the wealthy people who own homes on Cape Cod and out there in Martha's Vineyard and Nantucket, and they don't want to have the big windmills floating in off in their wonderful views of the sunrise. So how did you deal with all of their concerns?
Well, here was very interesting, because I will tell you that the developer for Cape Wind came into us into our office, and this is 2001, and he was the he had developed all of the most, if not all, of the combined cycle natural gas plants that it were, and that at that point were the cleanest, right, cleanest producing electricity producing plants, right, the combined cycle natural gas. But he said, seems to me you guys now have got a new policy here and incentives for encouraging renewable energy. And I've done my work, he said. I'm an independent power producer, and I produce utility-scale energy projects. And as I look at renewable, I know that's not going to be solar. It's going to be wind, and but it can't be land-based, because I'm looking at the ridges along Massachusetts and the mountain ridges. That's where it's going to have to be, and I just can't – that's going to be – difficult, just because of accessing, right, getting up there, but also because of view issues. And he said, I've decided that offshore wind, and offshore wind by that was already being developed in overseas, particularly in the UK, Netherlands, and Denmark. There was it actually had taken off, so he had observed that and said, let's do it here. And the first, and the, after giving us that pitch, he looked at all of us at the Renewable Energy Trust, and he said, so tell me what I have to do. And what happened, what was at that point in time, there were absolutely no regulations, no policies. There was nothing in place, even though Europe had been doing this for a while, that could, where you even knew where to begin if someone came up with that proposal. So it became, under the by default, the Army Corps of Engineers had jurisdiction, but they had no ability to permit. They were the Rivers and Harbors Act said that 1899 said the Army Corps of Engineers had purview over all structures built in navigable waters. So that was the closest you had. Now the U.S. Department of Interior did do offshore oil and gas, but as you know a little bit about government, they were mandated by law, and it specifically said offshore oil and gas. It didn't mention wind, so we had to wait until the next energy bill came up so that we could add, you know, wind to that mix. But in the beginning, it didn't happen. So here's what we did, and we got immediate pushback when the first offshore wind proposal, Cape Wind as it was called, certainly had to find the spot that would allow it to be built economically. And in those nascent days of offshore wind, it had to be close to shore. You had to minimize the cost, close to shore, shallow water, and close to transmission. And there were overlay map after overlay map after overlay map, right, to look at what's, you know, conflicting uses, underwater ordinances, and all this. And there was one little hole, and it was Horseshoe Shoal, that where you would have the room and the ability to produce or build an offshore wind farm, which met with immediate, as you mentioned earlier, opposition from a number of circles, including some of our most prominent politicians, but also Bill Koch and residents. So what we did at the trust is we created a stakeholder process. We called it the offshore wind stakeholder process. We didn't use Cape Wind, and it really was a way to try to provide everybody in Massachusetts, but particularly the people that would have been most impacted, with information that would allow them reach what we hope would be an informed decision about whether or not Cape Wind should be built. And what we did, we had 7 full day forums. My challenge was to get both the developer, and that was Jim Gordon from Cape Wind, and Energy Management Incorporated, to participate. He was a little reticent because he felt like maybe I'm going to be, you know, just hung out to dry. But he agreed, and then we had to get the major opposition, which is a group called Save Our Sound, that was organized, and to agree to do it. Anybody who's organized, and that wasn't an easy task. But once we got what I call those two bookends to agree to participate in these forums, we filled in the between. And basically what we were looking for was a manageable number of people, but these people had to represent all the interests that express concern over, or interest or concern in Cape Wind, was represented at the table. And so it was, we ended up with about 40 individuals. And then we also got the major agencies, both state and federal, as resources to participate over a period of 7 full day meetings. And here's what we said: we're not trying to reach consensus. It was too contentious to do that. What we are going to try to do is provide people with information to reach their own conclusions. And the only consensus, the only agreement that we're going to look for, is agreement over the resources, the people that we bring to these forums to speak to and address your concerns, whether it's migratory birds, whether it's fish, whether it's a seabed floor, whether it's economics, whatever. We're going to structure these meetings, and we're going to, and I mean this, and because we did have the resources at that time. That's the difference, once again, between maybe a place like the New Alchemy Institute and working for government, is because we had the resources to bring people from around the country, and I think in even some cases around the world, to come in and at least talk about the potential and try to anticipate what the concerns would be for offshore wind. Let me just quickly, I'm going to take a, the other thing that we did was we brought together engineers, wind turbine engineers, Jim Lyons from GE and others, together with the folks who were concerned about migratory birds and even the fishing community, and we tried to get them to talk to one another so that the engineers could hear the concerns that the environmentalists or the conservationists had, and start to see if they could address that even before he got out of the gate. So that was our approach. We wound up with something like a 2,000-page report that I think we were one of the first agencies that actually had to put the report on a CD-ROM disc. Anybody still remembers those? Mm-hmm. And I think it went a long way to at least educate the community and stakeholders and get that it was being debated over and over again in the press and the media, and that was unhealthy.
Yeah, well, and of course, you're talking a real case study of where the rubber hits the road. We can say in general, yes, we want renewable energy, and the fossil fuels are causing the climate problem, but then when you actually try to implement some of the renewable energy platforms and sources, you can run into some resistance. Hopefully, as people are now really getting how really dangerous this climate crisis is, you know, some of those calculations are going to change. And one thing that has changed a lot since you and I began on these tracks way back 30 years ago is that now the renewable energy is in many cases less expensive than the gas and the oil and even the nuclear. So
And that includes offshore now. Offshore has actually taken off, and especially, well, in Europe, by the way, also China. We went on a trade mission with the Governor Patrick to China, and actually were asked to conduct a workshop on offshore wind for our Chinese host. And this is, now we weren't the only ones. I'm sure they had also invited, you know, the UK and Denmark before us or after us. But we did that, and when we got back home, we were contacted by the Chinese engineers that we had visited, and they asked if they could come and visit us in the United States. And when they did that, they had a list of who they wanted to meet with, including the MIT professors. And by the way, China, we have a in a block island, we have a sort of an experimental offshore wind facility off the coast of Rhode Island, not a full-fledged, not yet. China has already passed us. They've got offshore wind farms up and going, and they see it as being part of their renewable energy future. So we're still behind. And even as you say, with the fact that the costs have now are much better than fossil fuels. One caution, and this is where the systems thinking sometimes is, you know, the systems approach reveals sort of, I think, truths. And one of those truths that you probably, that some people have heard about, is the fact that yes, offshore wind, the generation electricity from offshore wind is renewable, it's clean, but it still takes some practices that aren't necessarily that clean, right? We still have to mine for some of the metals that are associated with it.
And even for solar panels. I mean, there's mining that...
Absolutely. So
you have to look at the full life cycle of the whole system.
Absolutely. So we've got to, you know, and so now concepts like, you know, precision mining are becoming sort of part of the lexicon, part of our vocabulary as we talk about sustainability, and they have to be. But also, I will say this, even more global cooperation. So I'm going now from local, but getting back to this global sort of system. One of the things that during the Jimmy Carter administration, Buckminster Fuller approached Jimmy Carter, Pierre Trudeau, and Leonid Brezhnev, of all people, with this idea of building a world-around electric grid. And his thinking was that because of the intermittent nature of solar and wind energy, it was still sort of, even though the cost has come down, you'll still hear people say, yeah, but, you know, renewables can't provide what they call sort of the base load, right? A continuous supply.
Right, the dependability.
And reliable. And what Fuller understood was, but if you could build an interconnected global grid that could still be modular, you could still have your mini microgrids, but because it was interconnected, you would always have access to some part of the system where the wind was flowing, and the sun was shining. If you could get over and address the transmission issues over long distance, and he basically predicted. And the reason he got Brezhnev and Trudeau is because he said, when we get to the point where we can have high voltage direct current that can span the Bering Strait, we will be able to connect the world in an interconnected grid. And I think some people sort of, you know, they kind of nice idea, but it'll never happen. Interesting enough, you know, who has that concept on the drawing board at any rate and is moving forward, that is China.
Oh, fascinating.
To create a world grid. And, you know, there are all sorts of issues still associated that people say, well, but that's going to lend itself to terrorism because all you have to do is control. Well, there are ways of modularizing it. But the main reason for doing that is you would optimize the use of resources, right? You would only include the necessary redundancy, but not the redundancies that would unnecessarily consume inordinate amounts of resources. So it's a concept. It would, you know, it's got all sorts of implications, and of course, given the relationship and the tense relationship between China and the United States in particular, but it could also be a bridge to trying to address that tension for something that is going to benefit everyone. So it's worth watching.
We could hope so. We just have 1 minute left, and I want to make sure to ask you about the World Game Workshops, which you're now in charge of. Can you, in 1 minute, just describe what is the World Game and why are you reviving it now?
World Game, as you mentioned, is a global simulation. It basically is a role play in which we, and it's been used prior to our taking it on, was used in thousands of schools and businesses, corporations around the world to give folks a chance to explore the options for cooperation, global cooperation in a non-threatening environment. In a way that says, you know, quickly, Bucky said that the nation states are like blood clots because they disrupt the natural flow of resources, sort of like what I was alluding to with the world grid. And so the world game allows people to role play. They role play nations, existing nation states or regions or whatever. And the goal of the game is to say, how can you meet the needs of your particular constituents? And you'll get extra points, more points, if you can do that in a cooperative manner as opposed to doing it in an isolated form and start to realize those synergies. So it's a non-threatening way to explore how we can break out of this sort of conundrum, this sort of competitive nation state sort of all or nothing sort of scenario, either you or me, right? It's got to be you or me, or encourage kind of systems thinking that can maybe our only way to get out of this or to minimize and avoid the worst case scenario for climate change.
That's fantastic. Well, I please invite me to one of those. I definitely want to go to one of those workshops. And just finally, where can listeners learn more about your work? What's your website?
Website is www.worldgameworkshop.org. All one word, World Game Shop.
That's all the time we have. Greg Watson, thank you so much for being with us today and for all your important work.